So welcome to 36th lecture. In this lecture we will see current fed coupled circuit field analysis, right. In many of our problems in electrical machines and equipment, we have generally current fed systems. So typically, you know what happens, most of our devices are voltage fed, but we simplify the analysis by making it as a current fed FE analysis, because current is generally known to us in the process of analysis. We know already some current is flowing and then we analyze further things, but generally we should remember that all our devices are typically voltage fed, but for analysis purpose we take it, you know, current fed cases for understanding in depth behavior of field distribution and the corresponding performance parameters. More about it when we see actual examples. So now for a massive conductor, when I say massive conductor, that means we are actually considering eddy currents in that conductor, right. So that means eddy current effects are considered, and that is why this sigma is being considered, and then dabba A by dabba T is being considered. Because this is representing the induced voltage, induced electric field intensity and the corresponding induced voltage and eddy current, right. So now we start with del cross H is equal to J, our one of the Maxwell's equations, with displacement current density being neglected because we are in the low frequency region. So, del cross H is equal to J, J is replaced by sigma E, and E is minus del V minus dabba A by dabba T. Now, here remember this del V is not on account of charge accumulation, but is on account of the voltage that is impressed across the terminals of the coil, right. So, now here this going further, this H is B upon mu. And B is replaced by del cross A. So this becomes del cross H becomes this is equal to sigma E, and we invoke here Coulomb gauge, which we have seen in basics of electromagnetics. This is the Coulomb gauge, divergence A equal to 0, divergence A in general is equal to minus mu epsilon dabba V by dabba T, which is called as Lorentz gauge. But since frequency is small, you get divergence A equal to 0. And why divergence A equal to 0 has to be invoked? Because del cross of A is basically del divergence A minus del square A, that is the vector identity, and that is why del divergence A, when it is made equal to 0, you are left with only minus 1 over mu del square A is equal to sigma E. And now in place of sigma E, we replace this E expression here, and then we get this. Now, here one thing you should note, I think probably I mentioned earlier also. Now, this is representing the source current density, and this is representing induced current density. So, going further now, the functional for the above equation in the frequency domain is, now here again we have for this term, you get the well known expression. We have seen it in the previous lecture also, and this will give you the global coefficient, first the element coefficient matrix, and then by combining all element coefficient matrices, you will get the global coefficient matrix. Then you have this for the second term, this sigma dabba A by dabba T, dabba by dabba T will be replaced by j omega. So, sigma j omega A, so sigma omega and then that A become A square in the functional. We have seen earlier when the functional form, what did we see? Take the other terms except this on the right hand side, the sign of that basically gets reflected here in the functional term, and here you have A, one a is there, so that becomes a square. This we have seen when we studied functional, and then this half comes, right, because there is a square term here, that is why half comes here. So, this a becomes a square and j omega sigma as it is, right. And then this del v is, now del v is basically minus v by l. So, minus of del v is equal to v by l, because see, gradient of voltage is from low to high and E is from high to low, is it not? So, that is the reason that del V will be minus of V by L, because V by L is basically from, like when you say V by L, it is from positive to negative. So, del V will be equal to minus V by L, right. Effectively, it is like E is nothing but V by L, because E is from positive to negative. So, E is V by L. So, minus del, so V by L has to be minus del V, right. So, then is substituted here. So, del V becomes minus V by L, that is why you have minus sign. And again here there is no A, but then in the functional thing, this whole sigma V by L will get multiplied by A, right, in the functional expression with minus sign, as I just explained. I already explained you this comes for this. Now, the second term j omega sigma as it is here, this a square becomes this after FEM discretization, right, because a is replaced by summation I goes from 1 to 3 a n I a I e, and then further simplification you will get this with two summation terms, because there is a square term, is it not? And then this half is this half. And then this, for this third term, sigma V by L is anyway constant. A is replaced by summation Ni Aie. I goes from 1 to 3 summation, and then summed over all the elements. So, going further, now we have this capital B E at the element level. You will get sigma delta by 3. How this term is coming? Because basically you have sigma V by L here. Now, L, if you are doing 2D approximation, L is equal to 1, right. So, it basically is it is just sigma V, right. And then V is variable, unknown, because here it is current fed system, the voltage is unknown. So, here V is variable. So, now here only the sigma term is there, L is 1, and this we know that this integral, integral n reduces to delta by 3, and this AI, in the process of minimization, this AI will go, is it not? So, it is only summation n here, summation integral n, is it not? And integral n dx dy is simply delta E by 3, and this AI E will go in the process of minimization, and here it is only sigma V, because L is equal to 1 per meter depth we are doing. So, there is one typo here, this A should be N I here. So, this B is, that is why sigma by 3 into delta E, and L is 1. Right, and that V by L, so L is 1, and then this V goes in this matrix when we form the global coefficient matrix. So, now this is the global coefficient, global level matrix equation. So, that V E at the element level here, now here this V becomes this V. Now, we have to remember that all the elements will be
associated with
the corresponding one voltage, the corresponding voltage will be one, only one V voltage, right. So, that is why here this V comes. This C is our normal global coefficient matrix into the corresponding A vector, which is column vector of all the unknown magnetic vector potentials
minus B into V,
which I explained just now, and this is j omega dA, which is same as what we had seen earlier in diffusion equation solution, j omega dA. So, D basically is on account of this sigma, this term, is it not, because this is the corresponding diffusion term in the original partial differential equation. So, that actually basically will lead to this j omega dA. This we have seen it earlier in when we solved diffusion equation, we in fact had seen this j omega dA. So, this is our global matrix equation, and D at the element level is this, refer lecture 27 slide 6, here exactly the same thing. So, this is DE and this is D global by appending all element level D matrices, we will get this global D matrix as we have done earlier. The current in the massive conductor is given by this. Now, it is like this. So, suppose there is a coil here, which is fed by some I. Now, this coil conductor can be a massive conductor. So, this is a massive conductor through which this current is fed. Right. Now, this current when it enters, it will have not only this, you know, contribution from this source current, but there are going to be eddy currents in this conductor, massive conductor, because we are considering the conductivity, and there will be eddy currents in this. So, the current inside this massive conductor will be superimposition of this source current and the corresponding eddy currents induced. Right, but the total current will remain same because KCL has to be satisfied. If the total current here is I, current that you will get at any cross section here will also be I, which is integral J dS. At any cross section, if you integrate, whether it is this, or at the end, the current will be still the terminal current. But that terminal current now is due to the total current here, which is combination of these two terms, one account of the source and one account of the induced effects, right. So, now this is so integral j dot ds is and j we are replacing by this. So, this is the corresponding source current sigma V by L. Now, what is L? L is this length, and what is V? Is the terminal voltage V, is it not? So, V by L. So,
V by L is voltage per minute length.
And remember, this V is unknown. The terminal voltage is unknown. What is known here is the current that is fed. In the previous case, in the previous lecture, what was the case? Some known voltage was applied to one of the windings and the other winding was short circuited and current was unknown in both the windings. Here it is a massive conductor in which eddy currents are induced is fed by a current source and terminal voltage is unknown, right, and that terminal voltage is represented by this capital V. So, now going further, you have we are just separating out the terms, and then we are replacing A by summation I goes from 1, 2, 3 Ni Aie, our usual FEM discretization procedure, right. And then here, then we will get del V you substitute as V by L minus del V is V by L. This becomes sigma V by L, integral dx dy is simply the area of the triangle, because this sigma V by L is constant, right. Then you have sigma j omega delta by 3. Again, this ai is now unknown, that comes here as this column vector, right? And then this delta by 3, sigma delta by 3, because this integral n I integral n I dx dy is nothing but delta by 3. And then you have this in matrix notation. In frequency domain, you have you can write this equation, wherein now this g we have seen in the previous lecture is sigma delta by 3, we are denoting by the same notation. And again here, since A is column vector here at the element level, this is taken as transpose, so this becomes rho into column, so this gives you 1 by 1, so it is 1 by 3 into 3 by 1 will give you 1 by 1, which matches with the right hand side 1 by 1 matrix dimension. And now this T is at the element level is sigma sigma delta by L, and this V goes in this variable matrix, right. And then we have this global level equation. So this T becomes global here. When you turn it to global, what will change is only this was at the element level, so this should be, this is E here, delta E. When you take it to global level, this will become sigma summation delta E, because it will, all the element areas will get added, that is the meaning of taking it to the global level. So sigma summation delta E by L, right. And if L is equal to 1, then of course this becomes 1. So this is how your this equation, so this T in this equation will be this, V is voltage which is unknown at the terminals, and j omega G, now this G becomes global by combining all these element level G matrices, and A E becomes A global, and I is still same I, because I is only one value, the source square, this remains 1 by 1. So now we can write both the equations, one for the circuit and other for field. So the field equation is this, and the circuit equation is this, right. So same two equations are written here, field equation and is the circuit equation. But you have to remember that in this coupled system of equations, there are coupling parameters. So in this circuit equation, what is the coupling parameter? A, is it not? So this is in the circuit equation, this is representing the field, whereas in this field domain equation, what is representing the circuit? V, right. So these are the coupling parameters, then only, so these are not independent field and independent circuit equation, because we are solving coupled circuit field, so there have to be coupling quantities between two equations. So these are the coupling quantities. Here it is this, in this case it is this A, so A and V. Previously, when in the previous lecture, what were the coupling quantities? A and I, right. And then you know we had two windings there, so I basically was I1 and I2. So I1, I2 and A were the coupling quantities in voltage field case that we have seen earlier. Right. So here V and A are the coupling quantities, and that is what is the unknown. Right. So now the global combined equations are this, same, just are written with one modification. We are combining these two into one, like we did in the diffusion case. This become, now we are calling it C, global coefficient matrix complex. Is basically combination of this matrix and this matrix. So C subscript small c is capital C plus j omega d. You can refer lecture 27 slide 7 for this. So, this is the global system of equations. Now, here clearly this the matrix dimensions are marked, these n by n, is n by 1. So, this, you know, this also n by 1, this is 1 by 1. So, this matrix together will be n in n plus 1 into 1, n plus 1 into 1. So, this is also n plus 1, n plus 1 into 1, right. Similarly, this will be n plus 1 into n plus 1, because this is n into n. So, we have added one row and one column. So, this becomes n plus 1 into n plus 1, right. And then when we solve, so what is known here? I is known, and you know, you can get the whole right hand side, this is known, this is all known, right. And because t is this is function of sigma, this is just delta by 3, is it not? B is g is simply sigma delta by 3, right. So, all these quantities are known. This is only, this is function of only geometry and material properties, right. So, this is also known, this is our usual global coefficient matrix. So, all these are known. So, you take inverse and then you will get these unknown quantities, magnetic vector potential values in whole field domain and voltage across this terminal, okay. So, now let us see some examples. So, now this is skin effect of a current carrying conductor, right. So, exactly the same geometry, suppose this is a conductor and we want to find out the skin effect with current fed at some frequency, right. Now, here the question comes, generally the voltage, we have voltage sources feeding the conductor. So, if suppose you want to actually analyze this as a voltage fed, if current is not known, then you have to go back to the previous formulation and then excite this
conductor
by a voltage source, and then the voltage will be known and this current will be unknown, right. But you will get the same result, but here generally what we do, we simplify the analysis because we want to understand when some current is fed into a massive conductor with some frequency of excitation, how the currents get redistributed due to skin effect. That is why we generally feed, for analysis purpose, we feed into the conductor some current at frequency.
Because
current fed systems are easier to analyze as compared to voltage fed systems, and that is why we have this current fed FEM formulation. Okay, so now this this is a usual our skin effect, which we have obtained by using the code developed in the formulation described. You can clearly see the skin effect, current is trying to be at the more at the surface, and it is you know, less current is less inside the this inner part of the conductor. So, this, you know, can be simply understood by you know, I think I previously also I might have explained that if you can analyze this conductor by as made up of small annular conductors, you will find that the inside elements of the this whole conductor are linking more flux as compared to the outside. So, the inductance and the corresponding impedance offered by this inner part of the conductor is more as compared to outer part, and hence current tries to be at the surface. Now, actually same conductor which is fed by some current source, near that conductor we, if we bring in some, you know, conducting part, which is a plate here, a mild steel plate in which eddy currents are induced. Now, you can see this skin effect gets skewed because of this induced currents in this plate, you have the skin effect skewed. So how do we understand this? This is like, you know, in a very simplified explanation, this you can consider as two windings. One is LV winding, one is HV winding. Because this is the source, this is the, you know, induced currents are there in this. So the flux will be maximum in this part between the two windings, right? And then you will know from the field plot that the flux that is linked by this part of the conductor is more as compared to the flux linked by this part. That is why current tries to concentrate more on this, right? That you can understand from the field plot, right? And I think we have seen in basics also this proximity effect basically increases further the AC resistance, because effective area comes down further, because current is now trying to concentrate more and more on this part of the conductor. Now, you suppose if you have two conductors, then and here the currents are in the same direction. So, if the currents are in the same direction and if these two conductors are side by side, so here the geometry is something like this. These two conductors are there side by side and you have this boundary and currents are in the same direction, suppose say dot. The corresponding your field will be like this, and then you will observe that intuitively you can see this part of the two conductors facing each other, they will basically, they are linking most of the flux, because all the flux is being linked by these two inner parts of the conductors which are facing each other, and that is why the corresponding impedance offered is more and that is why current is less. Whereas these faces and the parts which are not facing each other, you will have some flux
contours
which are cutting, some flux
contours
which will be passing like this and like this. Those will not be basically linked by this parts, and that is why the corresponding impedance will be lower and hence current carrying will be more. So if you really want to see the corresponding flux plot and understand what I was meaning by this, you can actually see this virtual lab, this experiment at this website. So you can clearly see the flux plot there and then verify for yourself that in this case these two parts, these parts, they are linking more flux as compared to these parts, and that is why the current distribution is like this. The opposite case, when currents are in opposite directions. Now this is similar to this case, this geometry is similar to this geometry. So here also the currents were concentrating in the faces which are facing each other, in the areas which are facing each other. Same thing is happening here, currents are concentrating in the regions which are facing each other. Again, this is the same geometry, the geometry is same, only thing it is dot and cross for this case, right. So, this way you can understand skin and proximity effects, and these of course are very representative simple examples, but in you know, many of our devices like transformers, motors which are fed by power electronic circuits with, you know, frequencies significantly in excess of 50 hertz with lot of harmonics, this skin and proximity effects will increase substantially, and then this formulation can be used to find out the increase in losses and temperature rise in windings subjected to, you know, high frequency harmonic currents in such windings. So always remember that the complexity of the analysis further goes up, because you will have to then model individual conductors in the winding, right, and then but the formulation remains the same. efforts in terms of geometry, in terms of meshing will go up, but the efforts in terms of formulation remain the same, and that is the advantage of FE analysis.